Recorded Books presents The Women Back from Moscow in Pursuit of Beauty by Ha Jin, narrated by Catherine Ho. Chapter 1. Yo Mei was wondering why Jiang Ching wanted to meet after the evening class. They were both at Lushan Academy of Literature and Arts in Yan, the legendary communist base in the remote Shaanxi province. Ching was an instructor, Yo Mei a student. Both had come to this place the previous year, 1937. Yo Mei was 17 and Ching 24. But their seven-year age gap set them apart as if they belonged to different generations, especially when they were on stage and in the arena of love. They had known each other since four summers before in Shanghai, when they were in the Oriental troupe of modern drama. Yo Mei had been an apprentice there and even taken an acting class taught by Ching. At that time, the girl was still too green to perform in plays, while Ching, called Lan Ping then, was a burgeoning actress seeking her place in the Metropolitan's theater circle. In The Government Inspector, the Gogol comedy, Ching played only a minor role, a locksmith's wife, despite her moderate success as a starlet in several movies. That same year, however, she had managed to snatch a leading part, Nora, in Ibsen's A Dollhouse, and then another major role, Katerina, in Ostrovsky's The Storm. But here in Yan, Yo Mei, younger and more talented, could easily outshine Ching on stage. A few months before, they had acted together in The Blood Sacrifice in Shanghai, which commemorates that city's fight against the Japanese invasion 6 years earlier. Yo Mei performed the leading female role, the daughter of a rich capitalist, whereas Ching had to settle for a secondary part, the rich man's concubine. The play had been so successful that it was performed 20 times in the town of Yan alone, watched by more than 10,000 people. Some even perched on the trees around the platform to get a better view. Numerous communist leaders saw it and praised the performance. It was said that Ching had met Mao Zedong personally at one of her performances. Mao was so impressed by the troupe's recent productions that he suggested establishing Lushan Academy of Literature and Arts, and his colleagues unanimously supported the idea. After the performance season, both Yo Mei and Ching became well-known. Even children in the streets would call Yo Mei the Miss and Ching the Concubine. To a degree, Ching was annoyed by such notoriety, and she knew that as far as acting went, Yo Mei may have been getting ahead of her. In recent years, after her apprenticeship and before coming to Yan, the girl, Yo Mei, had acted in several movies and plays in Shanghai and earned a name for herself. She was already like a professional. Now the two of them were going to meet beside the grand Catholic church that boasted a pair of belfries and stood next to their academy. Yo Mei had never liked Ching, who, to her mind, was a second-rate actress who engaged in one affair after another in Shanghai. Some men had abandoned their families or attempted suicide thanks to her casual entanglements with them. Ever since coming to Yan, Yo Mei had tried to avoid Ching, following instructions from her mother, Ran Rui, who had arrived in Yan soon after Yo Mei and had also been a student here at the College of Marxism and Leninism. Ran Rui believed Jiang Qing was bad news, so Yo Mei had better not mix with her. There Ching was, walking toward Yo Mei with feet slightly splayed in suede boots. Tall and willowy, she wore a gray-blue woolen coat and an army cap. She was a kind of sartorial expert, good at giving advice to other women on what clothes to put on and how to alter a tunic or jacket. In this red base, most women just wore baggy gray uniforms like their male comrades, but Ching seemed determined to stand out by dressing differently.
Yo Mei, my little sister, Ching said with a faint smile. I'd like to talk about Yixin.
In the silvery moonlight, her mouth stiffened. Her left cheek's muscles twitched a little,
while her large eyes glowed. All right. What about him? Yomei asked, having in a way expected this. Yixin headed the education and training section of their college and was also a teacher in socialist thought. A lean, intelligent man, he could speak Russian, having studied in the Soviet Union 7 or 8 years before.
Yomei, I'd like to advise you, as an older sister who has gone through more in life,
Ching went on, her voice a little husky and uncertain.
You know, by rule, you're not allowed to carry on with a man like Yixin. An affair between a teacher and a student is strictly forbidden here. You might get him and yourself into trouble if you don't stop soon enough.
He's been kind to me, and I can't just brush him aside, Yomei replied honestly, even though she was unsure of her own feelings for that somewhat attractive man. I know you like him, Ching, but you mustn't blame me if he doesn't leave me alone. I'm only 17, too young to date, so I'm not that eager to go with any man.
Don't you hope he'll stop chasing you?
Ching looked her in the face, her eyes shimmering in the moonlight. Well, he's a leader of our college. I can't be rude to him.
Can I tell him to leave you alone?
Please, let me handle this by myself. Right now, I can only say this. If you two are in love, I'll step aside without interfering with your relationship.
I'm glad to hear that. Keep in mind, Yomei, you're still a young girl, and there'll be infinite opportunities for you. Everybody views you as Zhou Enlai's daughter, the Red Princess of Yan. But I am new here, with no one to rely on.
So you need a man like Yixin? Yomei asked, knowing Ching was often blunt and brash. A practical woman, indeed.
Yes, I need a man here. Truth to tell, Yixin is handsome and smart, but he may not be powerful enough to protect his woman yet. He's probably running after you because he intends to be associated with your dad, Vice Chairman Zhou.
I don't think Yixin is that calculating, Yomei said, her anger rising. If I'm fond of someone, I'll never badmouth him behind his back.
You're still young and innocent and believe in the purity of romantic love.
You don't, then?
Honestly, I don't. Perhaps because I've been betrayed by too many men. Trust me, Yomei. Most men just use women to advance their careers or satisfy their lust and vanity. You must take more precautions to protect yourself against them.
Thank you for telling me. Yomei felt annoyed and hoped to end their conversation.
Actually, you're such a smart girl that I don't need to dwell on this. You've already transformed yourself into a Red Princess. To be sure, you know how to promote yourself.
You think too highly of me, said Yomei.
You know I've always appreciated you. Do give thought to what I've told you.
Of course I will. Ching turned and strode away as if peeved. Her slanted shadow was wavering ahead of her in the pale moonlight. The night smelled of charcoal fire and was peaceful. A dog barked sleepily in the distance as Ching moved away with a swinging gait. It was whispered that one of her feet had 6 toes, but nobody had ever seen them. Legend had it that a person with 6 toes on 1 foot could be either a saint or a demon. Ching never revealed her naked feet, always donning socks. Even when wearing straw sandals, she would decorate the fronts of the shoes with red strings, which made them pretty and unique. People all agreed that Ching had refined taste and knew how to make herself up and dress smart. At a big locust tree, she veered to the left and faded into the night. Yomei turned around, heading back to her lodgings. A cockerel, confused about time, crowed as if dawn were breaking, even though it wasn't yet midnight. Here and there, bean oil lamps were glowing behind paper window screens, some flickering on hillsides. Yomei could tell that Ching must be irritated by her,
by her having to take such a drastic step, personally admonishing her rival to stay away from the man they both liked. That woman could indeed act aggressively. Even without provocation, she could be outrageous and menacing. Without further delay, Yomei headed for the cave room she shared with four other female students. A sentry demanded loudly,
"Password?"
"Flying red flag," she cried back. The man shone a flashlight on her.
"Oh, the miss,"
he snickered, then bowed a little and let her pass.
Chapter 2.
But Shu Yixin continued to pursue Yomei. The next morning, after teaching his class, Introduction to Social Sciences, he caught up with her and asked her to meet after dinner. Such a request flustered her, but it also pleased her. For the whole day, she was under the spell of a peculiar sensation, as if she were blushing constantly, even when she was alone. To some extent, Yomei adored Yixin, who had a lean face and was in his late 20s. He was also a noted figure in Yan. Within the CCP, there was a group of senior cadres nicknamed the 28 and a half Bolsheviks, who had all come back from the USSR, where they had attended Sun Yat-sen University, a school in Moscow established by the Soviets for training and educating Chinese revolutionaries. The group was headed by Wang Ming, a short, dapper man who, sent back by Stalin, was almost equal to Mao Zedong and Zhou Enlai in power. Wang represented the Comintern, the Communist International, which had been founded by Lenin 2 decades before as the international headquarters of communism. So even though Wang was not experienced in Chinese revolutionary work, he carried a lot of clout, was backed up by the USSR, and had been in charge of the United Front that tried to bring together all the forces in China to support the CCP. Yixin was the runt among those Chinese Bolsheviks, the half after the other 28, because he'd been so young, so inexperienced, that he hadn't always been able to function like the full Bolsheviks, and he was also less contentious than the others. Nevertheless, he was intelligent, with a strong memory, easygoing, and amiable. Every once in a while, he even served as Mao's Russian secretary. By the time he arrived at Lushun Academy of Literature and Arts, he was already a full-fledged revolutionary, a capable and outstanding leader in cultural affairs. In class, he would drop a Russian word or phrase, which impressed the students all the more. He was such a kind and articulate man that many young women were fond of him. His attentions to Yomei flattered her, though she was nearly 10 years his junior. Now she was wondering if she should bring up the topic of Jiang Ching to him. When Yomei reached the side of the Yan River, a little creek actually, he was already there waiting. He was wearing a flapped cotton hat and leggings, which made him look like a soldier on the front. His small eyes flashed as he smiled.
"I'm so happy you came, Yomei."
"Well, I'm here. What's new?" she said, her heart expanding with delight.
"I just want to talk to you."
He held her hand as if to claim a unique, intimate relationship with her. Instinctively, she wanted to pull her hand out of his grip, but didn't. Together, they turned, strolling along the gurgling stream, its surface shimmering while the water wound away into the distance. A crosswind tossed up some dried leaves, which skidded along the riverbank with a tiny crackling sound. Yomei noticed that his legs were slightly bandy, and that in spite of his wiry physique, he was healthy, sturdy like a Mongolian pony. He must have had women before, considering he had once lived in Russia, where he had undoubtedly rubbed shoulders with female revolutionaries. But Yomei knew that may have been part of his work. She asked him, "You know, as a student, I'm not allowed to have a relationship with a man, especially a leader." He smiled and said, "But I'm already 27, entitled to look for a wife." At that word, her heart leaped. She felt herself going red.
Luckily, the darkness covered her hot face. She ventured, "During your career, have you ever played the role of husband to a woman comrade?"
"Not really, but I have often carried out tasks together with female colleagues."
She'd heard that revolutionaries often lived together as couples, especially in the area of the White Terror, which was occupied by the nationalists and warlords, and communists had to operate in disguise. Some of the ad hoc couples had become lovers eventually, even though many also lost their marriages because their spouses couldn't stomach such infidelity. "Do you know Jiang Ching well?" she asked him.
"Not really, but she often comes to my office. She's eager to learn and has a lot of questions."
"She's interested in you for sure."
"Probably. But I want to be with you. She seems too smooth to be trustworthy."
Yomei stopped to face him. "Ching and I talked last night. She warned me not to mix with you."
"Why did she do that?"
He sounded surprised and a little irritated. "Because I'm just a student of yours."
"Even if you weren't here, I wouldn't feel comfortable spending personal time with Ching. Of course, I can respect her as a comrade. She's a decent actress."
What he said put her somewhat at ease. If push came to shove, she might tell Ching candidly that she wouldn't have a chance with Yi Xin anyway, so it would be unnecessary for her, Yomei, to back down. Before they turned around toward their quarters, Yi Xin kissed her on the cheek. And she kissed him back, but on the mouth. She liked his male scent, pungent like fresh grass, and his palm on her chest, for the first time, gave her such a thrill that she shook a little. 2 weeks later, Yomei was amazed by a new development. Jiang Ching left the academy and began to work at Chairman Mao's office as his personal secretary. The rumor was that an affair had just started between her and the top leader. That must be true. The two of them had appeared together at theatrical shows the week before. They were seated in the very front row, as if to flaunt that they were a couple. Ching also rode in the minivan, known as a breadbox car, designated for Mao's personal use. The vehicle had been donated to the Red Army by the immigrant community of New York's Chinatown for fighting against the Japanese aggression. Many young women here were astounded by such a breakthrough in Ching's life. How could she, without extraordinary looks or talent, manage to hold the great man in thrall? This was simply beyond everyone. Yet some people in the know believed that such a quick development, Mao's having another woman, might be inevitable. He was known as a kind of skirt chaser and often went to dance parties, which had been introduced to Yan by the radical American writer Agnes Smedley and also by Sophie Su, the wife of Shafiq Hatem, an American medical doctor. The Hatems had a phonograph in their cave house, which was a common dwelling in the Yan region, a cave dug on a hill slope serving as a home of two or three rooms. The couple often held dance parties at which coffee and soda were served in place of alcohol. As a result, social dancing was quite popular among the communist leaders as relaxation after the day's work. Some young women frequented those parties, but Yomei's mother wouldn't let her go, saying she was still too young to mix with men publicly. Her adoptive father, Zhou Enlai, was one of the best dancers among the leaders, able to move nimbly and gracefully. Besides, he was good at chit-chatting with his dance partners, showing a lot of personal interest and concern. Naturally, many women went up and invited him to dance. In comparison, Zhu De, the commander-in-chief of the Red Army, would dance as if he were marching formally, always moving forward without retreating. It was so hard for his partner to accommodate him. Still, the Office of General Affairs would make arrangements with some young women beforehand so that Zhu De wouldn't feel left out. Mao was notorious for his casual way with his dance partners, touching them here and there while moving with stiff steps. At times, he embarrassed them.
yet they never set a peep. One of the women had told Yomei, in private, that if another man had touched her behind in a dance, she would have given him a loud slap on the face. But with Chairman Mao, she had to bite her tongue and lower her eyes. Ching was an elegant dancer and had a sizable following, some of whom were young women eager to learn from her how to dance well. Naturally, she caught Mao's attention, and they began to exchange letters. After paying Mao a visit and staying a night with him, she was transferred to his office and put in charge of handling his correspondence. Ching was shrewd enough to seize the opportunity of his wife, Ho Zhichun's absence, and pretty soon they lived together like a couple. It was known that Mrs. Mao, Zhichun, had gone to Xi'an together with their daughter, Min, after a fight with her husband. Zhichun had caught him flirting with Wu Lili, who was Agnes Medley's English interpreter. Zhichun even attacked the young lady, calling her a rotten slut. She cursed Smedley as well, accusing her of shamelessly seducing Chinese men. Zhichun was a markswoman with a fiery temper who used to command a detachment of guerrillas. She saw her husband in the cave house shared by Smedley and Wu Lili and began cursing the young woman. Even though Mao yelled at her to stop, she got louder and louder instead, so he ordered his bodyguards to drag her out of the cave room. Wu Lili was a beauty of a sort who spoke English fluently and could quote Byron and Shelley and Keats off the top of her head. She and Mao had started carrying on clandestinely, though encouraged by Smedley, Wu Lili was still frightened of Zhichun. Smedley had bragged to others that she intended to wreck Mao's marriage because she despised Zhichun, while taking it upon herself to westernize Mao. On some level, to her, he may have seemed like a bumpkin who had never set foot outside China and had no clue what other countries were like, even though he was well-read and could toss out an English word or phrase from time to time. He had been learning the foreign tongue since his youth. Owing to this scandal, Agnes and Wu Lili sneaked away from Yan. Their departure, plus Mao's wife's absence, left a vacancy in his personal life. By now, Zhichun was in Moscow for medical treatment and refused to come back to Yan. Mao's comrades grew concerned, believing that he needed a female companion since he worked day and night, being totally absorbed in military operations and the underground activities in the region occupied by Chiang Kai-shek's regime. If a woman, ideally a wife, could take good care of him, that would make him emotionally stable and curb his nasty temper. Ching's new role in Mao's office surprised not only many young women, but also some men. Among them was Yi Xin, who for several days didn't know how to cope with such a turn of events. Yet his gut told him not to rush in developing his relationship with Yomei. He mustn't rile Ching. Instinctively, he felt that a vengeful woman could be implacable and destructive, so he refrained from seeing Yomei from then on. Obviously, Ching had become a power he'd have to reckon with. One thing was clear now, he could not afford to antagonize Mao's woman, who might sway the chairman with her pillow chats, so Yi Xin stopped seeing Yomei, not even speaking with her in front of others. She noticed him avoiding her. She got the message and felt hurt. But she began to shun him too, knowing that, at heart, he must be a timid man. Despite her effort to distance herself from him, she felt he had stolen her heart, and she was tormented by the loss. Yet she knew that however painful it was, she'd have to take her heart back from him if she could. Chapter 3. Yomei heard that her adoptive father, Zhou Enlai, had just returned from Wuhan, so she went to see him and his wife, Deng Yingchao. The Zhous resided in a cave house on the hillside near Mao's quarters, about half a mile from where Yomei lived. Even though they were her parents in name only, she had been calling them Dad and Mom ever since she came to Yan. Her birth father, Sun Bingwen,
had once been Zhou Enlai's close friend and had joined the Communist Party in Berlin in 1922 together with Zhu De, the current commander-in-chief of the Red Army. Zhou Enlai recommended both men, Zhu and Sun, to the CCP, though he was younger than they. 3 years later, Sun Bingwen went to Russia and then came back to China to be an active revolutionary. In April 1927, he was arrested by the nationalists, and they swiftly executed him. He left behind 5 children. His wife gave away their youngest daughter to her elder sister, unable to raise all of the kids on her own. Then she took her sons and Yomei to cities like Suzhou and Beijing and Shanghai, where with the help of the underground communists, Yomei began to learn acting. Then, in the fall of 1937, Yomei and her elder brother, Yang, went to Wuhan, where they found the office of the Communist Army. They entered the 3-story building and begged the staffers to send them to Yan, saying they wanted to join the resistance force to fight the Japanese invasion. The men in the office laughed at the girl and asked how old she was. 16, she said. They laughed again and told her, "You look 14, too young for us. Please go back to Shanghai." They kept Yang, however, who was well-educated and already a lanky 21-year-old. He could speak Japanese, having just returned from Japan after the war broke out full scale. Upon exiting the stucco office building, Yomei burst into tears. At this point, a handsome middle-aged man in a fedora got out of a limo, sauntering toward the entrance of the building. He asked why the girl was crying. She said, "I want to follow in my dad's footsteps, but they won't let me join the Red Army." "Who's your father?" he asked, amused. "Sun Bingwen." "What? Let me look at you again." The gentleman was astonished. "Are you little Yomei?"
"Yes. Who are you?"
"I'm your uncle, Zhou Enlai." Indeed, he had first seen her when she was still a baby. Later, when she was 5, Sun would bring her along to meet with Zhou so that she could keep watch for them over her dad's shoulder while they talked business. In other words, the girl had participated in revolutionary work when she was still a little kitty in pinafores. At Zhou Enlai's mention of his own name, Yomei stepped closer and looked him in the face. She then hugged him and said, "Uncle Zhou, they already took my brother Yang. Please tell them to have me too. I want to go to Yan." That was how both she and her brother came to the remote communist base where Sun Yang began to work for Commander Zhu De as his secretary, while Yomei entered the party's political college to study revolutionary theories. Soon their mother, Ren Rui, also came and joined them. Mother and daughter enrolled in the same school and often attended the same classes. They became a topic of town gossip, a kind of legend. After graduation, Yomei continued her studies at the Arts Academy, while her mother went to work at a kindergarten for the time being. Yomei felt attached to Zhou Enlai. He was warm and gracious, an attentive listener, and ready to give a helping hand to whoever needed it. His bright eyes, bushy brows, and elegant figure tended to produce a cheerful and charming effect on people. Yomei often heard young women talk about him, saying they'd do anything for him. Just the other day, a slender foreign reporter, whose mother was Swedish and father Cantonese, had openly declared she was willing to lay down her life for Zhou Enlai if he ordered her to die. Unlike those women who were bewitched by him, Yomei had mixed feelings. No doubt she was attracted to him as a man in his prime, but on the other hand, she also felt attached to him like a daughter. She had few memories of her birth father, who had been so dedicated to the revolutionary cause led by Sun Yat-sen that he had seldom spent time with his family. At heart, she had always tried to confine her feelings for Zhou Enlai within father-daughter parameters. Yet she could tell that whenever she was with him, he would become excited, his eyes radiating with happiness and his lean face glazed with a warm sheen. She was sure that his wife, Deng Yingchao, was aware of this too. That must be one of the reasons Mrs. Zhou had suggested they adopt Youmei as their daughter, since they had no children of their own. That plain, plump woman with smiling eyes and a pug nose was smart enough to establish a boundary between her husband and this beautiful girl. As long as they remained father and daughter, no extramarital affair would develop between them. Such terms were entirely acceptable and comfortable to Youmei. When she told her birth mother the Zhou's intention to adopt her, Ren Rui was delighted and encouraged her to stay as close to the couple as possible. In her heart of hearts, Ren Rui intuited that to survive in Yan within the communist rank and file, Youmei would need some protection. There wouldn't be more suitable adoptive parents than the Zhou's, with whom the sons had been longtime friends. Youmei's mother could trust the couple. Above all, Zhou Enlai was one of the most powerful men in the CCP, second only to Mao. The Zhou's looked delighted to see Youmei when she stepped in. Their room smelled good, redolent of tasty cooking. "Have you eaten?" asked Mother Deng. "Yes," Youmei said. "But I wouldn't mind sharing a bite. You know what a glutton I am, Mother." At that, Zhou Enlai laughed.
"Sit down and let us eat together."
"Thanks, Dad. I'm so happy to see you back." Dinner consisted of four courses: steamed dace, sautéed cabbage with cured pork, scrambled eggs with scallions, and a tofu seaweed soup. Thanks to Zhou Enlai's high rank, such fare was standard. All the top leaders here could have four-course lunches and dinners, whereas regular soldiers ate corn buns, boiled millet, black beans, and vegetables. At the communist base, such dining distinctions were strictly kept. For instance, even Yi Xin, a mid-level cadre, would eat two dishes at dinner or lunch. Top leaders like Mao Zedong, Zhu De, Zhou Enlai, and Zhang Wentian could also have 1 pound of fresh milk per diem. One reason Youmei loved to visit her adoptive parents was that she usually could have a hearty meal with them. Zhou Enlai was fond of fish and foreign wines. He picked up a big chunk of dace with his chopsticks and put it into Youmei's bowl of millet.
"Try to eat more," he said kindly.
They were seated in wicker chairs at a square table. While eating, they chatted about life in Yan. Father Zhou was curious about the lectures Youmei had been attending. Indeed, she often went to talks and shows. The Zhou's had no time to attend, but wanted to know about them, particularly who spoke about what and how well the talks were received. Recently, Youmei reported, she had gone to a lecture given by Chen Yun, the head of the CCP's organization department. The topic was how to become an excellent communist. The skinny man was lucid and eloquent, his talk quite engaging. Toward the end of the lecture, he asked the room whether there were any questions. A slip of paper was passed to him. He looked at the question, then, with his eyebrows lifting, read it out.
"The basic principle of communism is equality, but in Yan, why do we eat different meals?"
It said that Chairman Mao eats a chicken a day, whereas common soldiers like us haven't tasted meat for months. "Why is that?"
"Well," Chen Yun said with a straight face, "Chairman Mao indeed eats a chicken a day, but that's not his choice. Our revolution needs a strong, healthy leader, so he has to keep himself in good health. In other words, he eats chicken on our behalf, as a task."
Such a clever answer cracked up the whole room. Zhou Enlai chuckled and said Chen Yun was smart and hadn't wasted the time he'd spent abroad. That small, bony man had just returned from the USSR, where he had served as a representative of the CCP at the Comintern.
Yomei was amused by Father Zhou's remark about Chen Yun. The dapper man was indeed quick-witted and had the gift of gab. It seemed that those who were trained and educated abroad were much smarter than those spawned in China's villages and wilderness, and that they tended to have a broader perspective and a deeper understanding of the revolution. They all seemed more knowledgeable and more articulate. After dinner, over Aster tea, they chatted about matters at Lushun Academy of Literature and Arts. The Zhous had met Jiang Ching at Mao's office the previous day and were eager to learn more about her. Yomei said she had known Ching for more than 4 years, that they used to be in the same drama troupe in Shanghai. She was cautious not to reveal too much about Ching and just said the woman had been married before, maybe more than once. She broke many hearts, Yomei added without emphasis.
You mean she was promiscuous? Mother Deng asked, as if surprised.
I can't say that for sure, but she had some complicated relationships with men. The Zhous exchanged glances and seemed alarmed. Actually, Yomei added, I would say she always keeps her eyes on useful men. For example, she spoke to me just a month ago, warning me to stay away from Shi Yixin.
You mean she was after Yixin? Asked Zhou Enlai, who occasionally used the young man as a Russian interpreter.
Yes, she warned me that I'd break the rules if I had a relationship with Yixin.
Are you interested in him? Asked Mother Deng.
He's fine, but I'm not going with him. He brushed Jiang Ching aside and often came to me. Ching was unhappy about that, of course, but now she's at Chairman Mao's office and might not bother about Yixin anymore.
It's hard to tell, Father Zhou said broodingly. But Yomei, she's right about your breaking the rules, which forbid a young student like you to mix with a school leader like Yixin.
You mean I should stay away from him?
Yes, you mustn't start a relationship so early, he went on.
His wife added,
besides, don't cross Jiang Ching. An acrimonious woman can be dangerous. Father Zhou continued, I'll speak to Yixin. Both of you must be careful from now on.
Of course. I'll focus on my studies, agreed Yomei. Yixin seems to avoid me these days anyway. Later, she shared the content of that conversation with her birth mother, who had known Ching personally for 6 or 7 years. She also demanded that her daughter stop going with Yixin in case Ching were to take offense. Yomei assured her mother, saying with blazing eyes, no need to worry, Mom. I have torn him out of my heart.
Chapter 4. Zhou Enlai's talk with Yixin seemed to have shaken the young man. From then on, he avoided Yomei. When they ran into each other, he would just nod at her and at most say a few words in greeting. She could tell that he was breaking up with her, perhaps because Father Zhou had pressured him to do so, though she wasn't sure whether Zhou had done that out of worry about Ching's new role as Chairman Mao's mistress or out of paternal feeling for her, Yomei, since few fathers were willing to see their young daughters get intimate with another man. She wasn't really worried because Yixin was 10 years older than she was, and she felt she was too young to look for a man. True, she was drawn to him, but she wouldn't say she loved him. Probably it was merely a crush. She had a young aunt, Ren Jun, who was only 1 year older than her. Jun was small-boned and had smiling eyes. The two had grown up together like sisters, wandering through different cities and provinces. Together, they learned acting in Shanghai, where the actors treated the two of them as a pair of young apprentices. As a result, Jun also knew Jiang Ching personally. In some ways, Yomei was closer to Jun than to her mother. The two had so much to share and were able to confide in each other. Jun was also in the Arts Academy. She'd taken a minor role in a play now and then, since she was less talented than Yomei, and without her niece's kind of popularity.
This was also largely due to the fact that she didn't have Yome's looks and vivaciousness. Still, Jiang Ching tried to befriend both of them. These days, whenever they ran into Ching, she would invite Yome and Jun to visit her at Mao's residence. They knew the woman was vain, but didn't know that Ching was doing her best to befriend them for another reason, namely that she didn't want them to prattle about her past, particularly her many affairs and scandals back in Shanghai. Any revelation of her former ill repute could undermine her chances with Chairman Mao, because an amorous relationship between her and Mao would have to be approved by the principal leaders of the party's central committee, in which Zhou Enlai was a key figure with a decisive voice. Nowadays, whenever Ching saw Yome and Jun, she'd say, "Please come see me at my new place. We'll have tea and candies together." They would reply that they'd pay her a visit soon, but they never made good on their word. As a well-known beauty in Yan, and also as the daughter of a late revered revolutionary, Yome was familiar with many senior leaders' families. She knew Mao's wife, Ho Zizhen, and also their small daughter, Min. Yome had been to Mao's office twice, and the great leader had seemed happy to see her there, speaking with her like an amiable uncle. But now her feelings about that place had changed. Neither she nor Jun liked Jiang Qing, believing she was an opportunist, something of a social butterfly. Yet, no matter how displeased Qing was with them, she had to be polite to them because she badly needed Zhou Enlai's support. In fact, Ching also tried to ingratiate herself directly with Zhou Enlai, whose graciousness and affable manner she admired. Every once in a while, the two of them went out strolling or even riding together. Zhou Enlai was eager to ensure that everything was well with Mao's life and staff. Zhou used to be the CCP's number one leader, well above Mao, in full charge of both the party's political and military affairs. But he had no military talent or strategies. Worse, the German military advisor sent over by the Comintern, Otto Braun, a.k.a. Vida, was a capable strategist only on paper. Neither he nor Zhou, who both had a European background and training, had any concrete sense of the topography of China's countryside or the rural people involved in the revolutionary struggle. Consequently, in the early 1930s, they lost one battle after another to the nationalist forces, which drove the Red Army out of its bases to embark on the so-called Long March, which in reality was a protracted flight. Not until January 1935, in the small town of Zhunyi in Guizhou province, did Zhou turn around and, overruling the majority of the CCP leaders, let Mao command the Red Army. Since then, with the military fully in his hands, Mao's supremacy in the party could no longer be challenged. Zhou was convinced that Mao was much more capable and far-sighted than he was. Indeed, ever since coming to power, Mao had led the Red Army to outsmart Chiang Kai-shek's forces at every turn and defeat their attacks. Zhou believed that only Mao could navigate the party through all the perils down the road. That was why he was willing to serve Mao, playing second fiddle. For him, this was a matter of survival, not just his own, but that of the whole party's. One afternoon in the early fall of 1939, after giving a talk at the party school, Zhou Enlai left for his cave home at Yangjia Hill, riding his Mongolian pony and followed by his bodyguard, Zhou Zhou, a short 18-year-old marksman. Somehow, Jiang Ching appeared on the road, also riding a horse. So she and Zhou were heading back together. But upon reaching the Yen River, Ching struck her horse to urge it to speed up. That startled the animal, and it collided into Zhou's horse, which sprang up and threw him off. To protect his head, he put up his right arm, which landed first. The fall smashed his arm. Lying on the riverbank, he couldn't get up. His bodyguard dismounted and rushed over to help him to his feet. Zhou groaned, unable to move his arm anymore. Back in his cave home, His wife tied a band of cloth around his neck as a sling. They both thought he'd feel better after a good night's sleep, but he hurt all the more the next morning, perspiration soaking the back of his shirt. So they sent for a doctor. The doctor found that Zhou's arm was fractured. He'd have to be treated without delay. But the medical services in Yan were so primitive that he'd have to go elsewhere for surgery. At the news of Father Zhou's injury, Yomei hurried to Yangjia Hill to see him. She was angry at Zhou Zhou and blamed him for not being careful enough while keeping her father company. But Mother Deng stopped her, saying it was not the boy's fault. Father Zhou also demanded, "You must apologize to your younger brother, Zhou Zhou." She did. She was just a few months older than the young bodyguard, but he was shorter and looked like he was in his early teens, so she often called him younger brother. He was fond of her and not really offended by her outburst. Ma, after consulting with some leaders on the Central Committee, decided to send Zhou to the USSR for treatment. In no time, the Soviets agreed to arrange a plane to fetch Zhou. In its reply, the Comintern also summoned Otto Braun back to Russia on the same flight. The telegram didn't explain why. It just said there was a new task for him in Moscow. But Braun was already married to a Chinese woman, Li Lilian, a famous movie star who had come to Yan from Shanghai 2 years before. Initially, after he'd graduated from the Frunze Military Academy in the spring of 1932, Braun was sent to Manchuria to gather intelligence on the Japanese Guangdong Army that garrisoned on the southern edge of Siberia, poised to invade the USSR. He soon moved to Shanghai, where he could communicate directly with the Soviet Union and the Chinese Red bases in the remote provinces. In the summer of 1933, orders came from Moscow that he go to Rijin, the capital of the Chinese Soviet state in Jiangxi province, to join Wang Ming, the Russian-educated and appointed head of the CCP, assisting him in military operations. In the beginning, Braun gave disastrous suggestions right and left, which his Chinese comrades took for orders because he represented the Comintern, to whom the CCP was willing to defer. But Braun was sensible and discerning enough to see his own faults and limitations. Even after he lost his leadership, he openly acknowledged Mao's strategic superiority and was willing to learn from his Chinese comrades. However, Braun had another weakness. He was unable to control his lust or tear himself away from pretty women. From the moment of his arrival at the Red Base region, he asked the CCP to find a woman for him. Worse, whenever he chanced upon a pretty woman, he would accost her, offering gifts and inviting her out. Some of the women were already married, so his untoward attention often outraged their husbands, who kept complaining to the CCP's Central Committee about him. To contain him, they found him a woman. Her name was Xiao Yuehua. She was in her 20s and from a peasant family. Yuehua wasn't pretty, but she was strong and capable, good at singing and playing basketball. Yet when the topic of marriage was broached with her, she was reluctant because Braun was 10 years her senior and also fat and bespectacled, with protruding teeth, an odd smell, and a totally different lifestyle. All the same, some women cadres in the party worked on her and managed to convince her that this was an invaluable revolutionary task entrusted to her. So she and Braun soon married, and that made him happy and steady, though Yuehua wasn't pleased at all. She still had to eat differently, not being qualified for the kind of dining privileges Braun was entitled to. Worse yet, he often blamed her for stealing his food and powdered milk. His cookie tin always had some of its contents missing. They later had a child, a son, though soon after the long march, in 1935, she filed for divorce, and Braun agreed to let her go and to pay alimony of 600 yuan a month, which was a huge sum, considering that a schoolteacher in the local county could make around 100 yuan a year at the time. Then Li Lilian came onto the scene. She was attractive and charming, already a famous movie star. The moment she greeted Brown, in English, at a party, he was smitten and began chasing her. Since she was already divorced, she agreed to give him her hand. In most ways, Brown's lust and vanity were satisfied, and their married life was uneventful. Yet now, the summons from Moscow threw the couple into panic. He had to go back, he told her, and she wanted to leave with him, saying she mustn't live like a widow with a husband still alive and far away. But the Central Committee denied her request on the grounds that she had no passport, so they couldn't possibly get a visa for her on such short notice. Having heard that, Lilian cried so hard that she passed out. Now Otto Brown was leaving on the same plane with the Zhous. Lilian didn't show up, although several leaders were at the airport outside of the town gate to see Brown off. The night before, at Yangjia Hill, there had been a farewell party for him, which she hadn't attended either. Brown got drunk and told Mao and Zhude that he hoped to come back soon to fetch his wife if he had to work in Europe for a long time. His Chinese comrades still liked him in spite of his shortcomings. They all wished him good luck and promised to take care of his wife. The plane on the single runway turned out to be a large American DC-3 with 24 seats. This was the biggest aircraft that had ever landed here, and it surprised the communist leaders. Most passenger planes that came a few times a month were small Russian Kharkiv KHAIs with only 6 or 7 seats. Together with the Zhous and Otto Brown, there were some other passengers, including Chen Haocheng, a tall, bulky-faced man who was a professor at the party's political college, one of the 28 Bolsheviks in Yan. Professor Chen had lived in the USSR for 3 years and was fluent in Russian. He was suffering from a severe stomach ulcer and going to Moscow for treatment. Yomei recognized his 11-year-old son, Zhu Tao. She wondered why the boy was with his father. Zhu Tao explained to her that he was leaving for Russia too, and that his dad hadn't expected such a large plane. The previous day, the professor had even told the boy that they might head for the Soviet Union by buses and trains if tomorrow's plane was small with limited seats. Now father and son were elated to see such a spacious DC-3 that could carry everyone here. It was said that his U.S. aircraft was Chiang Kai-shek's personal plane and that he had dispatched it to fly Zhou Enlai to the Soviet Union for medical treatment. Since the nationalist government had lately agreed to join hands with the communists in fighting the Japanese Imperial Army, this was an occasion for Generalissimo Chiang to show his magnanimity. To her surprise, Yomei saw that, together with Zhu Tao, was Tiger Gao Yi, the 10-year-old son of Gao Gong, the CCP's regional chief of Shaanxi province. Both boys had powerful fathers and were going to study in the USSR. A twinge of envy jabbed Yomei. She knew that many children of the top CCP leaders were already attending school in the Soviet Union, such as Mao's 2 sons and Lin Bozhu's daughters. Suddenly a small boy broke out wailing, stamping his feet and refusing to get off the plane. He was Chen Boda's son, merely 6 years old. His dad was running Mao's Office of Military Affairs and was here to see the Zhous off. The 6-year-old, nicknamed Little Tiger, wanted to leave together with his older pals, and no matter how hard his nanny cajoled him, he wouldn't leave the plane. All the adults were astonished, not knowing what to do about him. Some laughed. His dad was embarrassed, but since he was always indulging the boy, Chen Boda said to Professor Chen, "Can you take him along?" All the men on board laughed again. But the boy wailed, "I want to go to Russia like Yi and Zhu Tao." Zhou Enlai said to his father, "If you feel comfortable letting him go abroad at such a tender age, maybe he can go with his pals too. It will do him good in the long run." Mr. Chen lowered his eyes, then raised his round chin. He said to his son, "All right, you can go with your buddies. But you must listen to the uncles and aunties after you get there." The boy nodded with a smile and went over to sit next to his friend, Zhu Tao. Yomei worked up her courage and pulled the front end of Zhou Zhou's jacket, saying, "Younger brother, I want to go to Russia too. Can you speak to my parents for me? I can help take care of my dad." The bodyguard went up to the Zhou's and said,
"Yomei wants to go study in Russia too. Can't you take her along? She'll be a good student there."
Zhou Enlai, his thick brows pitched together, answered,
"No, we might not be able to take her with us. I'm going to Moscow for medical treatment and also for work, and I was instructed by the Central Committee to go there only with my wife. It's like a job or a task I'm supposed to carry out. If Yomei tags along, what can I say to Chairman Mao?"
Overhearing those words, Deng Fa, a dimple-cheeked man with sparkling eyes, the president of the party school, half-joked, "Yomei, the plane won't leave for an hour. You still have time to get Chairman Mao's approval." To their astonishment, she said, "All right, I'm going to his office to ask for his permission." She borrowed a bay horse from Deng Fa's bodyguard and mounted the saddle and dashed away. On arrival at Mao's courtyard, Yomei ran into Ching, who stopped her. "I want to see Chairman Mao," Yomei told her.
"What for?" Ching said, batting her large eyes.
"To get his approval. Please, Sister Ching, let me in. The plane is waiting, and I need Chairman Mao's permission immediately."
"You should have scheduled an appointment. You can't just barge in. Chairman Mao is extremely busy and mustn't be disturbed at this moment."
"Who's there?"
came Mao's metallic voice.
"Chairman Mao, I want to see you and need your permission," shouted Yomei.
He stepped out, smiling with his eyes tilting toward his temples.
"How can I help you, Yomei?"
"My parents are at the airport. I want to go to the USSR with them, but my father won't take me along unless you approve."
"All right, I will let you go with them. You need a note from me?"
"Yes. Please tell them you allow me to go."
She followed him into his office. He took out a piece of paper and wrote with a squat pen, "I agree to let Comrade Sun Yomei go to the Soviet Union." He paused to ask her,
"For what?"
"To study."
He added those two words.
"Off you go,"
he said, and handed the note to her.
"Study hard in Russia."
"You haven't signed this yet," she reminded him.
"There's no need. They can tell it's my handwriting."
She thanked him with a bow and went out. At the sight of Ching, she cried,
"Thank you so much, Sister Ching. I'm leaving with my parents for Russia. Take care."
She waved the piece of paper, which crackled as if the words on it suddenly came alive. Ching's lips twitched and stiffened. She smiled and said, "Lucky girl. Safe travels and come back soon." She waved as Yomei strode toward the horse tethered to the willow outside the courtyard.
"I will."
Yomei mounted the horse, galloping away. When she got back to the airport, the plane's propellers were already spinning, tossing up dirt from the new runway that went through the middle of a threshing floor. She showed Mao's approval to her parents. They nodded, both pleased to take her abroad with them. As the plane was taking off, shaking like a boat, Father Zhou chuckled and said to her,
"You're still wearing sandals like a country girl."
She looked at her straw shoes, which were almost tattered, held together with hempen strings. Mother Deng said,
"Don't worry, we'll get you a new pair in Lanzhou."
Brown, who looked gloomy, was seated at a tiny square window. He didn't say anything to the Chinese passengers, though he knew the Zhou's and Professor Chen well. He still seemed unhappy about the summons from Moscow.
Chapter 5. In spite of the turbulent din, Otto Brown, still heartsick about having left his wife in Yan, managed to talk with Zhou Enlai through Professor Chen's translation. Brown was upset, his eyes flickering with red rims. His lips curled and stopped just short of a grimace.
"How come it's so easy for these kids to go to the Soviet Union?"
They all have a visa? He asked. Zhou smiled and said, We made an agreement with our Soviet comrades long ago to send some children there to study, so we had their papers prepared beforehand.
Then I still don't understand why Lilian can't come with me. She's my legal wife. This makes me feel like a fraud just using a Chinese woman.
We double-checked with the Comintern. They instructed us that you go back alone. I'm sorry about this, Otto.
That will make Lilian believe I've taken advantage of her all these years.
I totally understand, Zhou said amiably. We're all revolutionaries and often have to sacrifice our personal interests and happiness.
I know that, but I don't see the necessity in my case.
We're in a similar situation, having to obey orders from the Comintern even though we might not understand their reasons.
You think they're all rational?
I don't see why I should doubt them.
Yume had been following their conversation attentively, though she didn't appear to be listening. She liked and even worshipped Lilian for her vivacious personality and mellifluous singing voice and for her gorgeous figure. Few actors at the time could act in both movies and musicals like Lilian. Now, that woman, only in her mid-20s, may have been abandoned. How heart-wrenching this situation must be for her. Yume also felt that Lilian had been used or misused. Intuitively, she reminded herself that she must take care to avoid that kind of situation in the future. So many revolutionaries seemed to have no second thoughts about leaving their spouses behind when they were ordered to pull up stakes. If this was the way they would act, why get married in the first place? It was irresponsible. At the Lanzhou airport, Yume saw squadrons of fighter planes and asked Father Zhou why those Russian aircraft were here. He explained that those Soviet pilots were helping China fight Japan, which was also Russia's perpetual enemy. Lanzhou was a transitional point where the materials and weapons sold to China by the Soviet Union were gathered. The fighter planes were shipped here straight from the USSR and then flew inland to deliver themselves to the Chinese military or to participate directly in air battles. Yume had witnessed Japanese planes bombing and strafing civilians, but never had she thought that China had its own air force, even if it belonged to Chiang Kai-shek's army. The Zhous stayed in Lanzhou for 3 days and then flew to Dihua, present-day Urumqi, where Father Zhou bought Yume a pair of brown leather loafers with tassels, which made her beside herself with joy, never having worn such nice shoes. Seeing the girl's new footwear, Mrs. Zhou frowned a bit, then told her husband with a smile, You've never been so open-handed with me, Enlai. Yume is a young girl, and we mustn't let her appear shabby in front of foreign comrades.
Mother, I'll buy you beautiful shoes when I make money, the girl enthused.
Mrs. Zhou nodded and said, Just enjoy yourself. I was joking with your dad. You don't need to worry about the future.
They stayed in a spacious suite in a two-story building for the night. The hotel was quite elegant, surrounded by weeping willows. It used to be Warlord Sheng Shicai's personal residence, but now served as a guest house, mainly to accommodate the communist cadres and officers passing through, because Sheng Shicai needed the capable military personnel of the Red Army to help him build his mechanized battalions equipped with Russian vehicles and automatic weapons. Two more children joined the Zhous at the guest house, Liu Yunbin and his sister Ai Qin, whose father was Liu Shaoqi, a key leader of the CCP running its Central Plains Bureau. The boy was 15 and the girl 11. Together with them were also those boys who had arrived on the same plane with the Zhous. Yume was the oldest among these youngsters. In total, there were 6 of them, all regarding her as an elder sister. After dinner, the kids gathered in the room shared by Yunbin and Ai Qin. Over hot cocoa made by Yunbin, they chatted about their future plans. Little Tiger was too young to know what he would like to study in the Soviet Union. He just wanted to go there and have a good time with his buddies.
The other older children all wanted to study sciences and specialize in industrial fields. Their parents, all experienced revolutionaries, had urged them to avoid military academies because the officers sent to China from the USSR had turned out to be incapable and often made terrible blunders, and because the CCP had adept officers galore but lacked experts in almost every civil field. So the parents all wanted their children to specialize in a subject that could be more useful for the new China they'd been fighting to establish. Unlike Yumei, none of them was interested in the arts or the humanities. She realized she might be a black sheep among them because she was eager to study theater, which was her passion. She had talked about this with her adoptive parents, who both supported her choice, saying she could specialize in whatever she preferred and that the revolutionary cause could use all kinds of experts. That night, she wrote a letter to her aunt Jun, to whom she hadn't been able to say goodbye when she left Yan in a hurry. She didn't reveal her destination to Jun, and just said she'd write her again once she settled down. She also gave Jun her mother's new address in Chongqing, where Ren Rui had just transferred to the office of the 8th Route Army, where she was to direct its library. Yumei enclosed a 5 yuan bill for Jun, saying she had no need for such money anymore. Indeed, she'd soon be using rubles instead. The Zhous stayed in Dihua for about a week. Zhou Enlai had many matters to attend to, talking with Sheng Shicai and meeting the communist cadres working in the region to ensure that this place, so close to the Soviet Union, would serve as a secure base for the CCP in the future. There were other children and wives of the communist leaders on their way to Russia for medical treatment and recuperation, and also for education, but some of them were yet to arrive at Dihua. So the Zhous and Professor Chen, unable to wait for their arrival, were going to leave for the Soviet Union before them. The two men and Mrs. Zhou and Yumei bid the kids goodbye, hoping to see them in Moscow soon. Meanwhile, the children needed to learn as much Russian as possible from Uncle Peng, a senior officer who knew some Russian. The next morning, the Zhous and the Chuns boarded a smaller plane to Almaty in Kazakhstan. Yumei was thrilled to see down below the Great Wall, battered and broken in places, like a giant sleeping python stretching along mountain ridges to the edge of the sky. Then the forest disappeared, replaced by an immense desert swelling with endless sand dunes. "Now China is behind us," said Professor Chen. Zhu Tao, his son, and Yumei nodded solemnly, as if too awestruck for words.
Chapter 6.
In Almaty, they boarded the train to Moscow. The trip took them 4 days. When they arrived at the capital, at Kazansky Rail Station, Ren Bishi, a chubby man in his mid-30s, was there to meet the Zhous and the Chuns. Yumei recognized him. Uncle Ren, who was the CCP's envoy to the Kremlin and had come here 2 years earlier to brief Stalin on the progress that the CCP had made in recent years and on China's resistance war against the Japanese. Yumei had known Ren for years. He was a sweet man who treated her like his own child. When he smiled, his thick mustache would tilt up at both ends like a pair of little bird wings. They got into a flat-topped passenger van, which took them downtown, directly to 10 Gorky Street, to the Hotel Lux, which was also the Comintern's dormitory. This was where the Zhous would stay, since many Chinese Cominternians were also living in the mid-rise building. Professor Chen and his son would lodge elsewhere. The professor had lived in Moscow for some years and still had friends here who would accommodate him and his son. Zhou Enlai would be treated at the Kremlin Hospital by the best doctors there, though he wouldn't be hospitalized. An interpreter, Shi Zhe, would accompany him. Mr. Shi was Ren Bishi's secretary and represented the CCP at the Monina International Children's Home, which had received the majority of the CCP leaders' children in the USSR, some of them orphans. Shi Zhe
had once studied engineering in a military academy in Kyiv and was the most fluent Russian speaker in the CCP. The Zhous were pleased to have him as their companion at the Kremlin Hospital, which was known to the Chinese as the Russian Royal Hospital, so Mrs. Zhou thanked Ren Bishi for all the arrangements he had made. Meanwhile, Zhou Enlai was also to work on behalf of the CCP and the Comintern. He knew many people and had a lot of business to handle here. After lunch in the Hotel Lux's cafeteria, tomato soup and smoked sausages and artisan rolls, Professor Chen and his son left for his friend's place. Still unsure of what she was going to do, Yomei was pleased to stay with her parents for now. Their suite had three rooms and was rather shabby, with two north-facing windows that didn't let in a lot of sunlight. But the Zhous had become accustomed to a bohemian lifestyle when they had been young revolutionaries, so they were satisfied with the lodgings. From the next day on, Yomei would go out to see the surroundings. She was greatly impressed by the architecture and artwork in public places. There were even sculptures in some parks, bronze and stone figures of workers, soldiers, national leaders, proverbial heroines, mounted warriors, even some gigantic birds, eagles, doves, swans. The Russians must be art lovers, better educated than the Chinese overall. Their excitement over the public display of artwork made Yomei more determined to study here. She hoped she could get into a theater school, but that seemed out of the question before she learned enough Russian. 2 days later, when Uncle Run came again, they talked about Yomei's plans to stay here. He hadn't expected to hear that she would specialize in theater arts. Indeed, she was a rarity among the youngsters from China who all wanted to study a useful subject like one of the hard sciences. To Yomei's delight, Run produced two books that could help her learn Russian. One was a concise Russian-Japanese dictionary made of thin glazed paper and cloth-bound. At the time, there was no Russian-Chinese dictionary yet. The other was a book of Russian grammar by Liu Zhirong, a well-known professor who had taught Russian at Peking University before the Japanese invasion. Yomei loved the books so much that she could hardly put them down. Even though she didn't know Japanese, thanks to the Chinese characters Japanese shared, she could figure out the meanings of most of the Russian vocabulary. She remembered that Yishin, the man who had courted her briefly in Yan, had owned a copy of such a Russian-Japanese dictionary, which was even harder to come by in China. The word book had been published by Whitewater Press in Tokyo, in a small printing, mainly for the Guangdong Army stationed in Manchuria as part of the preparations for Japanese soldiers to invade the Soviet Union. Since Yomei couldn't be of much help to the Zhous, Mother Deng urged her to start her studies as soon as possible. The girl could see that her presence in the suite was a hindrance to Father Zhou, who constantly had to meet people in private. Uncle Run suggested getting her enrolled for now at the KUTV, the Communist University of the Toilers of the East, so that she could settle down and start her student life without delay. At the mention of that school, her heart leaped and her eyes lit up. She knew it was a mecca of sorts for international revolutionaries and that numerous renowned figures had been educated at the KUTV, including the heads of some nations and communist parties in Asia and Africa. Yomei knew there were many KUTV alumni among Chinese dignitaries, Deng Xiaoping, Liu Shaoqi, Chu Chobai, General Ye Jianying, Cao Jinghua, professor of Russian, and even Chiang Kai-shek's young son, Jing Guo. But Uncle Ren Bishi made clear that she was only going to be a temporary student there, mainly to study Russian so that she could get into a theater school in the near future. The Zhous believed this was a sensible arrangement, saying they entrusted their daughter entirely to Uncle Ren. Yomei left with Ren in the minivan. They were going east to a suburban town called Kuchina. It was already late fall, the streets strewn with leaves and pedestrians wearing windbreakers and hats and headscarves. On the way, Ren Bishi explained to her they were going to Section 7 of the KUTV, where 24 or so Chinese comrades were already enrolled. He said that the KUTV was also his alma mater and that he was still well connected with it, so Yomei mustn't hesitate to ask him if she needed help. 20 minutes later, they entered Kuchina District and then pulled up in front of a long two-story building that housed the school's administration and some classrooms. Pointing at the building shaded by acacia trees, Uncle Run said that Yomei should come here to register and fill out her paperwork after she settled in. Having walked across a playfield and then a poplar grove, they stopped at a white wood cottage with tall windows. This was obviously a dorm, cozy and gable-roofed. The surroundings were peaceful and bucolic. Yomei liked the solidity of the house. She had noticed that Russian architecture was much sturdier than that in China, as if everything here was built to last. A lot of stone and brick and timber were used. They went up to the second floor and entered a room with wide planks on its floor. At the sight of its occupant, a round-faced Chinese girl, Run said,
"Hey, Lily, I brought you the friend I mentioned."
He turned to Yomei and introduced them.
"This is Lin Lily."
The two girls shook hands, grinning at each other as if they'd met before. Indeed, Yomei had already known quite a bit about this girl. Uncle Run had told her about Lily in some detail. The girl had come to Moscow the previous year with a group of children and sick wives of CCP leaders, including Deng Xiaoping's ex-wife, Ha Jin. Lily was the third daughter of Lin Bozhu, one of the five grandpops in Yan who had joined the CCP in 1921, the very year it was founded, and who used to be in charge of the Red Army's finances and logistics. The old man was revered for his integrity and frugality in managing public funds. Lily had been at the KUTV for 15 months and was already attuned to the environment and could speak Russian decently. Uncle Run said that from now on, the two of them would stay together and that Lily should help Yomei get accustomed to life here. The girls seemed to like each other instantly and promised him that they'd get along. He gave Yomei a sheaf of crisp banknotes, 700 rubles, saying she should get some suitable clothes and things for everyday use. Lily told him,
"Rest assured, we'll go out shopping this afternoon.
Also, help her get registered for a Russian class and a political course."
"By all means. She's my charge now," Lily said with a smile, which dimpled her left cheek.
When Uncle Run had left, Lily took Yomei out to show her the college grounds. Lily had heard that the premises were a gift recently given to the CCP by the Soviet Union. Yomei was pleased to stay at such a tranquil place, like a village back in China, but this was definitely inside the city, like an oasis. Her new friend went on to explain that she, Lily, hadn't joined the other Chinese youngsters at the International Children's Home that was about to move away from Moscow because she was older, and the CCP officials here thought she might start dating soon. Lily giggled and said,
"I guess you'll be the same."
"How old are you?" Yomei swatted her on the shoulder.
"I'm 18.
"How about you?"
"Me too. I was born in October 1921. I'm also a rooster. We're the same, two domestic creatures, and should get along fine."
"I was born in June, 4 months older than you, so you should call me older sister."
"All right," Lily agreed.
"I'd love to have an older sister here."
Together, they walked farther into the campus. Behind the classroom building, on the other side of the playground, stood several white clapboard houses that served as dorms and a kitchen and a canteen. And there was also a kindergarten that cared for about 20 kids, a few of whom were Chinese and whose mothers were students at the KUTV. Beyond those houses spread a wood of pines and oaks, through which a trail curved away. As the two of them followed the path, Yomei saw squirrels chasing one another in treetops, their fluffy tails flashing.
A few were running on the ground, now and again foraging through the year's decaying leaves. At the end of the woods flowed a babbling creek, its water clear and cool. On the waterside, a flock of wild ducks were waddling with heavy behinds, flapping their wings and letting out lusty quacks. Yomei was amazed to see the waterfowl unafraid of people. Lily said that besides studying Russian, she had been taking three courses this semester: the Soviet Constitution, political economy, and the history of world communism. Every class was taught by a Russian teacher and then translated by a Chinese interpreter in the classroom. But such concepts were nebulous and even alien to the Chinese students, such as productivity, superstructure, surplus labor, worth and value, and the stages of capitalism, and the interpreter didn't know how to render them into concrete, comprehensible terms. In such cases, the students just wrote down the words. They were told to remember them in Russian for now. By and by, the words would make sense to them. After lunch in the school's canteen, cabbage soup and rye bread with butter, the two girls went out shopping. At a large clothing store, Yomei spent almost 300 rubles for two shirts, a pair of pajamas, some underclothes, and two brassieres. Lily said Yomei must develop a different sense of money from now on. Here everything was expensive, but they each received a decent stipend, 460 rubles a month from the Chinese program at the Comintern, so they mustn't appear shabby and should even splurge every once in a while, going to the movies or the theater. Yomei said she'd like to see every play staged in town. Yomei joined Lily in the Russian class. They were taught by Vera, a housewife who conducted conversation with them with the help of her son Sasha, a meatball of a little boy who had milky skin and orange hair. "Can we learn genuine Russian this way?" Yomei wondered. But she was glad Lily was also in the class with six others. She told her Chinese classmates that she was here to study theater arts, so she must give all her time and energy to mastering the foreign tongue first. Her explanation prevented others from making her join their political curriculum. They all believed that specializing in theater studies was a task assigned to her by Chairman Mao. It was known that the great leader had personally allowed her to come and study in Moscow. Though she had enrolled at the KUTV, she did her best to avoid taking courses of abstruse and slippery revolutionary theories, which might be beyond her. She would even try to use as little Chinese as possible so as to learn Russian faster. Lily could speak the foreign tongue, though she still hesitated when using it, and had an accent. Yomei had learned a bit of Russian back in Yan, so she could tell that Lily conjugated her sentences quite well without making obvious mistakes in gender and cases and tenses, although she still tripped over a word or phrase once in a while. Lily was amazed to see the grammar book Uncle Run had given Yomei, saying she had been looking for this very book for some time without success. Yomei was more than willing to share it with her. In return, Lily showed her the textbooks she had been using. Whenever Yomei had questions, her friend was ready to explain to her patiently. Yomei was behind everyone in the language class and had to work harder to catch up. Every morning, she would stroll around, reading out passages and memorizing words and sentences. It was already winter, and sometimes the cold air, plus her overused voice, gave her a sore throat. But she forced herself to practice oral Russian for at least 2 hours every morning. Lily was impressed by the progress her friend was making. Indeed, Yomei soon could say some basic phrases in Russian with ease, such as, "Thank you very much. This is great. Let us go. What a beautiful child." And, "How are you?" On Sundays, she'd go to downtown Moscow to see the Zhous. Father Zhou had just gone through surgery, which, he was told, was successful but wouldn't be effective enough to restore the full use of his arm. Yomei was delighted to see that Father Zhou could move his right arm a little in spite of his tourniquet. He said he had gone through 3 rounds of diagnosis by expert orthopedists at the Kremlin Hospital, and that the chief surgeon had suggested opening the elbow fully and reconnecting the bone, but Father Zhou had preferred the less invasive procedure, have only the protruding piece of bone cut off, which could restore the arm to its original form, in appearance at least. He was told that after the procedure, his arm should recover enough to become functional in the near future, but wouldn't regain its full use. That was good enough for Father Zhou, who had so many things to deal with here and was unable to be an invalid for long. Thanks to the successful treatment, the Zhous decided to return to China in the spring. Uncle Ren Bishi was also going back to Yan'an with them, but Father Zhou assured Yomei that he'd make arrangements with the Comintern to ensure that she could continue to stay and study here, provided that she was accepted by a drama school. That was something she'd have to achieve by herself. Uncle Run also talked with Lily and told her that most of the adult students at the KUTV would return to China soon, while she and Yomei should stay in Moscow on their own for 7 or 8 years. The party would need all types of experts, and the two of them, still so young, should study for several years here to become more capable and more useful to the CCP. Lily said, of course, she'd be happy to remain in the USSR. With Uncle Ren's help and through an office of the Comintern, Yomei was put in touch with the Russian Institute of Theater Arts. She was excited, but also nervous, unsure if she could get into that school, which was regarded as the heart of theater studies in the Soviet Union. She shared the good news with Lily, who was thrilled for her, too. Then, in mid-February, Yomei and Lily moved to the Hotel Lux, which would become their dorm once the Zhous left. Yomei wanted to stay with her adoptive parents as much as possible, even though she and Lily shared a room below the Zhous and had to ride the tram to the KUTV for classes. The two also went to plays downtown, especially those at the Moscow Imperial Theater, where they saw Carmen, Tolstoy's The Power of Darkness, and Gorky's The Lower Depths. Though they loved the performances, the tickets were expensive, usually more than 10 rubles a seat. On occasion, they got free tickets from the Comintern's office in charge of the affairs of the Chinese students and visiting cadres. Whenever that happened, it was like a holiday for the two girls, who would spruce themselves up a bit for the evening. By disposition, Lily was more somber and wanted to study philosophy or revolutionary theories, but she was fond of Yomei for her vivacious personality and her hearty laughter. She was eager to help Yomei figure out how to get admitted to the Russian Institute of Theater Arts. "You must think I'm nuts to study theater here, don't you?" Yomei once asked. "No, it's a great career choice," Lily said. "Who's to say that a drama artist won't be more useful than an architect or a bridge engineer to our country in the future?" Yomei seized her friend's warm hand and gave it a shake. She knew Lily had in mind the Chinese boys, who were all eager to study weaponry and technology. They even looked down on those who wanted to specialize in the arts and the humanities, viewing them as having inferior minds. Then, Yomei heard from the Theater Institute officially. Its letter stated that she'd have to pass an audition to get admitted. That thrilled her, though she knew this wouldn't be easy. Fortunately, she was never afraid of performing in front of strangers. On Monday morning, February 12, 1940, Yomei and Lily went to the Theater Institute for her audition. A stalwart professor in his mid-40s named Nikolai Gorchakov and a woman in her mid-30s, Katina Lestov, led them into a rehearsal hall. Through Lily's translation, they told Yomei to perform something, anything, a song or a dance or a scene of a play, to demonstrate her ability. They understood that Yomei couldn't speak Russian well yet, but she could use any language, as long as she could show her talent. Together with the teachers were several men and women who must have been actors, and they all took seats in the front of the rehearsal area. Behind them stood some set pieces, a black upright piano, a brown organ, a floral screen, and a grandfather clock whose brass pendulum was motionless. With supple footsteps, Yomei got to the center of the room, which had floor-to-ceiling windows. She said she was going to sing a love song called The Blue Flower that was quite popular in northern China, particularly in the Red Soviet region in Shanxi province. The professor nodded his approval. She asked for a stool or chair, and a young man came over with a leather footstool and placed it next to her. Yomei sat down on it and began acting as if at a spinning wheel. Then she started the song, her voice crisp and so energetic that it sounded rather piercing, while her hands were busy weaving at a piece of phantom fabric. Green thread and blue thread, all the bright colors are forming a blue flower. So lovely it delights me. Among all the crops, sorghum stands the highest. Among the girls in the 13 provinces, blue flower is the most beautiful. In January comes the marriage broker, and the engagement takes place in February. The bridal money is handed to my father, so my groom will come to bring me home in April. When she was done, she stood up and bowed to the spectators. They clapped their hands, all looking uncertain, as if a little puzzled. Katina accompanied the two Chinese girls out of the rehearsal hall and said they would inform Yomei of the results in a month or so. On their walk back, Lily confessed that she wasn't sure how well the folk song had worked on the auditors, but Yomei's performance was lively by Chinese standards. Lily also felt it might have been a little too rustic, though she was impressed by the bell-like clarity of Yomei's voice. But who could tell what those theater professionals really liked? They might take the love song as something original, full of joie de vivre. She assured Yomei not to worry. The die was already cast, and all they could do was wait patiently. When Yomei told her parents about her audition, Father Zhou was pleased to know she had performed The Blue Flower, one of his favorite songs. He said that Chinese artists ought to stick to their own tradition in order to find their place in the world. Without question, Yomei had made the right choice with that song. As a top leader of the CCP, Zhou Enlai wanted to meet with some Chinese students at the KUTV and see how well they were doing. The announcement of his visit excited the students, some of whom were his comrades sent over to study and get trained for more consequential jobs in the future. Yomei accompanied Father Zhou to the KUTV on a windy afternoon, and Lily went also with them. The classroom turned livelier the moment Zhou Enlai entered. He waved at the smiling faces and said, "Hello, everyone. I'm so happy to see you here." Right in the front row was a wavy-haired man in his late 20s. Father Zhou recognized him and went up to shake hands with him. The man was Liu Yalo, who used to be in charge of educating the cadres and officers at the CCP's counter-Japanese military and political university back in Yan'an. Like Yomei, he had just arrived and had been learning Russian so as to get into the Frunze, the military academy nicknamed the Brain of the Red Army, to study the combat operations of large corps. Yomei went to the front, turned around to face her schoolmates and asked them, "Can we sing a song together to welcome Vice Chairman Zhou?" They all supported such a suggestion, so she started a song while beating time like a conductor without a baton, her chestnut-shaped eyes smiling. Together, they belted out the folk song, the Vagrant's Ballad of Fighting the Japanese Invaders. The curved moon is dragging a long shadow over the hills and on the roads. We're wandering around and miss home. Tell me, where is your home? My home's beyond the Great Wall, beside a broad road. Our village faces the Songhua River. Is it Wang Village? Yes, that is my home village, but I haven't seen it for 9 years. It was a long ballad that told the story of how the vagrants' homes were robbed and burned down and how ferocious the Japanese soldiers were to the civilians. Most of the students in the room were not good at singing at all,
and many sang out of tune. Yalo, his sparkling eyes trained on Yome the whole time, followed her hands while crying out the lyrics. He couldn't sing at all, but he was so excited that he just recited the words loudly. The whole room could hear him reciting the lyrics. Lily loved Yome for her ability to organize a chorus so spontaneously. Though new here, Yome often went to the front of a classroom and taught others how to sing a song that was popular back in Yan'an, beating time with her narrow hands while smiling merrily. In the beginning, Lily had butterflies in her stomach for her friend, but Yome seemed to have no sense of stage fright. She was such fun, full of spontaneous grace. No wonder so many men enjoyed her presence among them. Zhou Enlai was amused, and the instant they finished singing the ballad, he told Yome,
"Let us sing another song that everybody knows. This is really delightful."
So she started another one, the Big Sword March. It was a popular song among the soldiers of the 29th Army who had fought the Japanese Imperial Army in Hubei Province. Now the whole room chorused in one voice, "Big swords fall on the devil's heads, all our armed brothers. Now's the time to battle against the Japanese invaders." Unlike most leaders, Zhou Enlai did not enjoy giving formal talks, so after the singing, he started conversing with the students. They asked him about the prospects of the war against the Japanese aggression back home. He explained that the CCP had been doing its best to collaborate with the nationalist government so that China could maintain a united front, but there had been problems, even skirmishes, with Chiang Kai-shek's regime, which seemed more determined to undermine the CCP's efforts to keep the autonomy of the Red bases. Therefore, the party and the Red Army must remain vigilant against the reactionary forces in China and must continue to build the popular trust and confidence in the roles that the CCP had been playing in the war. In answer to Liu Yalo's question about the importance of the Soviet Union to China, Zhou Enlai spoke more like a top communist leader, saying that in his opinion, the revolution led by the CCP was a continuation of the October Revolution started by Lenin, though the Chinese communists were facing their own domestic tasks and challenges. For instance, China was a poor country with a huge population and lacking in natural resources. As he spoke, he was clearly aware of the Comintern cadre, a skeletal man wearing a tawny soul patch among the audience, and Zhou was certain that whatever he was telling the Chinese students here would be reported to the Russians. But with diplomatic savvy, he praised the USSR, saying that the Soviet communists had been big brothers to the CCP, helpful and generous with their resources and experiences. He emphasized, "The Soviet Union is our rear base, on which we have to rely in order to survive the White Terror. See, some of you were sick and wounded back in China and came here to get treated and to recuperate. Without the support of the Soviet Union, we wouldn't be able to survive all the upheavals that plunged our party into danger time and again." He stressed that this was also Chairman Mao's view. So the CCP had to follow in the CPSU's footsteps to build a strong socialist China ruled by the proletariat, but they had to drive the Japanese invaders out of their homeland first. Zhou Enlai also discussed the European situation with the students. He said he worried about Germany, where Hitler seemed to be going to extremes in his so-called national socialism. In Zhou's view, Hitler was dangerous and could become detrimental to the European communist movement. For example, the Nazis had already started persecuting Jews in Germany and had invaded Poland. But he believed that the Soviet Union was the invincible bastion against all the international reactionary forces. So every one of them here should be hopeful and confident. The world had no use for pessimists, and true revolutionaries must be optimists and always believe that the human race is capable of self-improvement and making social progress, that a better life awaits us ahead. In short, they all should feel fortunate to be at the KUTV able to concentrate on their studies while their comrades back home were fighting bloody battles. It was a warm, inspiring conversation. Afterward, many students told Yomei that they admired Vice Chairman Zhou very much. Some also tried to get close to her, even saying she was undoubtedly actress material and wishing her luck with her application for the Russian Institute of Theater Arts. Yalo was also one of those who had been following Yomei. He often turned up at the table where Yomei and Lily were having lunch or dinner in the mess hall. He would just shoot the breeze with them. From the Zhous, Yomei learned that Yalo had been married and had a son. Yomei, having noticed Yalo's interest in her, was very careful when mixing with him because he was a family man. At the same time, she wouldn't want to offend him, knowing he was one of the most brilliant young officers in the CCP. He had been a division commander even in his early 20s. Because he was better educated than other officers, Chairman Mao didn't send him to the front to fight for almost a decade. The great leader wanted to preserve the best officers for the Red Army. That was why he had been dispatched to Moscow to study. Once he learned enough Russian, he would attend the Frunze Military Academy to learn to become a military strategist. Lily, however, didn't like Yalo that much, mainly because she felt he was pursuing Yomei too aggressively. He even warned other men to back off because only he himself was entitled to make friends with the beautiful new arrival. To Lily, Yomei, youthful and charming, deserved a better suitor than him. So whenever Yalo sat down with them, Lily would snort, "Why are you here again? We are all students and have tons of homework to do." She also tried to persuade Yomei to avoid him. In fact, Yomei wasn't eager to be associated with him, knowing that, though divorced, he had been quite thick with another woman, Su Liwa, who had been helping him with his Russian and was living in Moscow with her mother and younger brother. Above anything else, Yomei pictured herself differently and dreamed of becoming an artist who would act in plays and even direct a few. She felt vaguely that theater arts should be the center of her universe, though she couldn't articulate this thought yet, knowing that as an artist, she must serve the revolutionary cause as well. Chapter 7. Those youngsters who had come to the Soviet Union after Yomei were now at a children's home called the Interdorm, which was about to move to Ivanova, a city known for its large state-run textile mills, about 200 miles northeast of Moscow. Before the youngsters left for Ivanova, the Zhous went to see them at the Interdorm's current location, in an idyllic compound in Monina, an eastern suburb of Moscow. They brought the children some toffees and peanut brittle as a gift from the CCP. Yomei helped her parents distribute the presents to the youngsters. She gave Lily's younger sister, Linlin, an extra pack of candies. The girl, in her mid-teens, was lovely, with a sunny face and stood out among the Chinese kids. Yomei was delighted to see the boys and girls who had finally gathered here. Little Tiger was almost half a head taller than last fall and already spoke Russian without hesitation, having played with local kids every day. Even when Yomei asked him questions in Chinese, he would answer in Russian. His face was still pale, though it had lost some of its baby fat and developed some delicate features. He said he disliked the food here and missed his mom and dad. Before heading back to China, the Zhous again went to Yomei's campus, Section 7 of the KUTV, to see some wives of the CCP leaders, such as Mao's third wife, Zizhen, and Deng Xiaoping's ex. Yomei accompanied the Zhous on these visits, knowing the women personally and calling each of them auntie, though they were only in their 30s. Chairman Mao had married Jiang Ching the previous winter, although he hadn't officially divorced Zizhen yet, so people here still regarded her as Mao's wife. Zizhen was staying in a dorm on campus, together with her 4-year-old daughter, Min, who had just come from China to join her.
Mother and daughter lived in a suite with a bathroom, two beds, and a square dining table that could seat six and also served as a desk. Zizhen's eyes were fierce, radiating a hard light in which Yomei could see anger, probably exacerbated by a touch of madness. Recently, Zizhen's friends here had read a TASS journalist interview with Mao in Yan, which in passing mentioned that the chairman was accompanied by his gracious young wife, Jiang Ching. So Zizhen concluded that Mao may have married another woman. But to her mind, the marriage was illegitimate because they were not divorced yet. She often said that Mao always used women relentlessly and had to have sex every day. Wearing a glossy bob with crimped bangs, Zizhen told Mr. Zhou, "Enlai, our party ought to give a right name to my status now that Mao Zedong is living with another woman. The Russians must already know he dumped me. That's why the personnel here have begun treating me and my daughter like a nuisance. The other day, the head of this program even threatened to put me in a mental asylum. I can't remain in limbo like this. I want to know who I am." Yomei could see that, physically, Auntie Zizhen was already a wreck. The woman was often short of breath and perspired copiously whenever she got excited. She had been injured many times in battle and still had more than 10 pieces of shrapnel in her body, which even the best Soviet doctors couldn't take out and which still gave her dull pain on rainy days. The agony had made her more irritable. Mr. Zhou tried to console her, saying he would certainly pass her request on to the Central Committee back home, that everything would work out properly. For now, she must take it easy and focus on her recuperation. She didn't seem to listen to his advice, nor could Mother Deng's consoling words calm her anger. On the other hand, Zizhen seemed happy to see them, partly because she and Mother Deng were longtime friends. She thanked the couple for bringing her the box of Chinese books that the Zhous had obtained through Run Bishi's help, some of which, the illustrated ones, were for Min. Yomei noticed that, emotionally, Zizhen was no longer stable. Whenever her small, timid-eyed daughter wanted to go out, Zizhen would yell at her and even pinch her cheeks, which were already chafed. The woman seemed to take her rage out on the child randomly. As the Zhous were leaving, Zizhen said to Zhou Enlai in a rasping voice, "Please tell Mao Zedong that he still has his family in Moscow, even though we just lost our youngest son, Liowa, to pneumonia. I buried the boy in the flower garden on campus and go visit him every morning." The Zhous had heard about the loss of the 8-month-old and agreed to relay the sad news to Mao. They knew that Mao's two sons from his previous marriage were both studying here and living away from the other Chinese students in their own lodgings on Gorky Street downtown. But the two boys got on well with their stepmother, Zizhen, and often came to see her. That was why she claimed that Mao's family was still here in Moscow. She seemed determined to keep her hold on her husband and his children, still acting like the matriarch of the family. The visit to Auntie Zizhen threw a shadow on Yomei's mind. The woman used to be full of vigor and guts, but now, at age 30, she was already a madwoman of sorts. Evidently, she had been damaged, perhaps by her entanglement with the captivating ideal that had inspired so many young people to join the revolution, or simply by the powerful man, Mao, who had chosen and possessed her, and finally ruined her. The Zhous also went to a hospital downtown to see Ha Jin, who had been Deng Xiaoping's second wife. His first wife had died in childbirth. Yomei knew quite a bit about Ha Jin, a legendary woman with bold eyes and heavy brows. She had loved Deng Xiaoping enough to marry him, but their marriage had not survived the relentless persecution within the CCP, which had once gotten Deng stripped of all his positions and also incarcerated. Later, when he was released and rehabilitated, their marriage crumbled. Ha Jin had by then fallen for Li Weihan, who was in charge of investigating Deng's case and had been Deng's perennial rival in the arena of love. Li and Ha Jin had been attracted to each other long ago, and now they began to resume their relationship. Deng Xiaoping was crushed by the disintegration of his marriage, but he never blamed Ha Jin. Here in Moscow, it was reported that she had lost her mind and was being treated as a mental patient in the hospital. Inside the ward, a large room for five patients, Ha Jin looked normal, wearing brown sneakers and a gray woolen jacket that brought to mind the uniform of the Red Army's senior officers. Yomei was surprised to see her hair shorn at the nape. Ha Jin used to have long, abundant hair, which was envied by other women, but she looked so odd and crazed now that Yomei tried hard to avoid her gaze. Yet Ha Jin appeared calm and at ease, and was evidently delighted to meet with the Zhous. She thanked them for coming to see her. She said she liked it here and was able to read a lot, but she missed her child back in Yan'an. She regretted having left China without her 2-year-old boy, and she begged the Zhous to keep an eye on her son when they got back.
"Of course, Ha Jin," said Mrs. Zhou. "Your child is also ours."
"Tell Wei Han, I'm all right here and will speak Russian better than him."
Her current husband, Li Wei Han, as well as her ex, Deng Xiaoping, had both lived and studied in the Soviet Union long ago. So for her, to come to Moscow for treatment and recuperation was more or less like a return to a home base. At the moment, Deng Xiaoping was the commissar of the 129th Division of the Red Army and had just married another woman. Ha Jin even encouraged Mrs. Zhou to come join her here in a year or two so that they could go pick mushrooms together in a nearby forest. Yomei was startled by such a bizarre suggestion and wondered if the woman had a screw loose, but Mother Deng, though healthy and hardy, said she would consider coming here for a restful vacation after their revolution succeeded. That meant once Red China was founded, which might take decades, given all the formidable odds the CCP had to fight against. In fact, Ha Jin wasn't an ornery woman at all, but at times she looked flighty, her broad eyes shifting and flashing. She kept smiling at Lily, who was serving as their Russian interpreter on this occasion. The girl used to be under Ha Jin's leadership at the KUTV before the woman entered the hospital. Ha Jin had once served as the secretary of the CCP branch among the students here. Even though Lily wasn't a party member yet, she'd still had to report her thoughts to Ha Jin regularly. Now it was awful to see this respected auntie in such a wretched state. To Yomei, Ha Jin might be another damaged woman if her mind was really as cracked as people believed. It was indeed difficult for women to survive the revolution, especially those brimming with vitality and idealism and elevated sentiment. The brightest and most capable of them tended to break down first. At the same hospital, they tried to see another woman from Yan'an, Liu Chunsheng, who was Bo Gu's wife, not yet 30 years old, who had also come to Moscow for medical treatment. In Yan'an, she'd been notorious for having come up with this wisecrack. On the long march, every donkey or mule was superior to a husband. She'd said that because so many men had gotten their wives pregnant, regardless of the women's suffering and desperate struggle on that arduous, dangerous trek. It was whispered that her husband, Bo Gu, resented her flippancy, which set their marriage on a decline, since the popular remark embarrassed many leaders of the CCP. Here she was diagnosed with dementia and placed in the mental ward on the top floor. Through Lily's translation, a head nurse told the visitors that Chunsheng was dangerous, and that was why she was confined to a single room. They stopped at the door, but were allowed to see her only through a tiny opening on it. Indeed, the woman's eyes were dull and stiff, her strong face harder and manlier than it used to be. The sight of the madwoman upset Yomei, though she said nothing. To her knowledge, Chunsheng's husband, Bo Gu, a Soviet-educated leader in charge of all the CCP's cadres, hadn't remarried yet, but he was cohabitating with another woman in Yan. What was unusual was that Borgu and Chunsheng had married in Moscow 12 years before, when they'd both been enrolled at the Sun Yat-sen University here, so they had viewed this city like a hometown, the cradle of their idealism, love, and revolutionary careers. Now she had landed here again, alone. Oddly, the wife's return to Moscow reminded Yomei of the conventional custom. A bride would go back to her parents' home when her marriage ran into trouble. She knew that Father Zhou had been seeing some Soviet officials to make arrangements for the Chinese children and expats who were in the USSR. He had also been trying to persuade the Russians to release a former top leader of the CCP, Li Sun, imprisoned since the previous year on charges of being a Trotskyist and a foreign spy. Zhou Enlai assured the Soviets that he had known Li Sun, one of the 12 founders of the CCP, for many years and could vouch for his loyalty to Stalin. In reality, it was the CCP's Central Committee that had ordered Li to stay in the Soviet Union as its liaison. In other words, his gathering inside information on the Kremlin was largely due to his official mission here. In addition to that role, Li Sun had been editing a newspaper, The Times of National Salvation, in support of China's fighting the Japanese invasion. Zhou Enlai pledged to the Soviets that in every way, Li Sun was a dedicated revolutionary, a trustworthy comrade. In terms of seniority, Li was similar to Zhou and had been the party's de facto head in the late 1920s. He was a man of integrity and charisma, though he could be a little too radical and hot-headed and lacked real experience and flexibility. What's more, among the top CCP leaders, Li Sun was one of those deeply connected to the Soviet Union. Besides having lived in this country for more than a decade, he had married a young Russian woman, though he'd already had two broken marriages. Yomei had met his wife, Lisa Kishkin, a foreign language student at a teacher's college who had lucent, prominent eyes, her dark hair twined into a long braid. Lovely and sturdy, Lisa was at least 15 years Li's junior. From time to time, Lisa came to see the Zhous, imploring them to intercede on behalf of her husband, who she insisted was a good man and a genuine communist. Yomei admired Lisa, who seemed to love her husband unconditionally. Lisa said that the Department of Internal Affairs, the predecessor of the KGB, had demanded that she divorce Li Sun and expose him publicly as an enemy of the Soviet Union, but she had refused. Instead, she went to one prison after another in search of him. She feared they might have banished him to Siberia or the island of Sakhalin. Sometimes, after a whole day's looking for him in vain, she wandered alone in the city at night for hours on end. Finally, one afternoon, she located him in the notorious Taganka prison, known as Moscow's Central Detention House, where an old warden told her that she could bring her husband some money. But she was just a graduate student, with a monthly scholarship of 250 rubles for living expenses. Still, she managed to give her husband 60 rubles every month, plus the food she took to him: bread, cheese, butter, peanuts, tomatoes, carrots, onions, cucumbers, pickled mushrooms, and eggplants. Also tobacco leaves. Thanks to Zhou Enlai's intercession, Li Sun was released toward the end of 1939. Lisa was rapturous to have him home again and told Yomei, "I always believed Li Sun would come back, liberated and reinstated. He's a pure man I can trust. He and I are both beholden to your dad now." Lisa's effusive words touched Yomei and set her mind spinning with thoughts. To her, this was an example of what true love should be like: constant and unaffected by circumstances, serving as an inner compass for one's life. but the Lees had lost their lodgings at the Hotel Lux when the Lee-san was arrested, so the couple had to go and stay with Lisa's mother now. To make matters worse, the Lee-san had no job and for months had been looking for work to no avail. Yome had heard so much about this man and would love to meet him, though their paths would cross only years later. For now, even Lisa seemed to have disappeared.
Chapter 8.
In early March 1940, Yome heard from the Theater Institute that it had accepted her, offering her a full scholarship that was renewable annually, provided that her grades were decent, above B on average. Finally, she could study theater arts in Moscow. The acceptance letter stated that she was the first Chinese student they had ever admitted, and that they hoped this would herald a significant beginning. She wasn't sure whether they had accepted her because of talent they had perceived, or thanks to some assistance from the Comintern. Probably both. She believed that Father Zhou must have spoken to some officials in charge of international affairs there. The Soviets might intend to educate her in dramaturgy as a kind of cultural aid to the CCP. To some extent, this was verified when she broke the news to her adoptive parents. Zhou Enlai smiled, obviously delighted, and said to her, "Our party needs all kinds of experts. You must study hard and make the best of this opportunity and turn yourself into an accomplished artist."
"I will, Dad," she promised.
"Now I can tell Chairman Mao that the Soviets want to train you to become an expert in theater.
Please thank him for me, too."
Before heading back to China, Zhou Enlai spoke with some Soviet officials about the children of the CCP leaders studying in Russia. He asked them to treat the Chinese kids generously and also to avoid putting them in danger because many of them had already lost their parents. The Soviets agreed to do their best to preserve the bloodlines of the Chinese communists embodied by these children. Yome was almost 19 now, so she was on her own and was treated like a regular international student. Zhou Enlai entrusted Yome and Lily to a Comintern cadre named Margilov. The man promised to watch over the two young women, but he also suggested that they get naturalized because that would facilitate their full participation in Soviet life and society. The suggestion took Zhou Enlai by surprise, though he knew that some young Chinese had married Russians and other foreign nationals and decided to live abroad for good. He told Margilov, "That should be up to the girls to decide for themselves." Yet when Margilov spoke with Yome and Lily about this, they both shook their heads and refused to apply for Soviet citizenship. Among the Chinese students, there was a moniker for those who had married foreigners and settled down in the USSR permanently. Musty bread, which referred to the type of food that had lost its freshness and nutrients after being kept somewhere for too long. Neither Yome nor Lily wanted to become musty bread, and they were convinced that they'd go back to China in the future, so the Comintern no longer insisted on their naturalization. Yome's theater institute was downtown, far away from the campus of the KUTV. But fortunately, she and Lily could continue to live at 10 Gorky Street after the Zhous left for Yan'an. Uncle Ran found a new room for them in the Hotel Lux, one with two beds and some basic furniture. Both Yume and Lily were elated about this arrangement, which would improve their lives considerably, even though Lily had to take the tram to school twice a week. But she would graduate in a month or two, so they were happy to have their new lodgings downtown now. After the Zhous and Uncle Run had left, on the first day after they had moved into their new room, Yume lit their small butane burner and made dough drop soup with oats, eggs, crushed tomato, and sauerkraut. She cooked a whole pot of it for dinner, which Lily loved and ate with a lusty appetite, saying she hadn't tasted Chinese food in ages. Yume had two big bowls too, but she said cooking took too much time, so they should avoid making meals. Lily agreed, also believing they ought to devote more time and energy to their studies. so from the next day on, they subsisted mainly on bread. Yomei liked sweet stuff and lathered her toast with jam or jelly, while Lily ate hers with butter or cream cheese. Occasionally, they also had pickled vegetables like mushrooms and gherkins and onions. In the mornings, the two of them often went out together, trudging through the snow-covered streets and crossing the Moskva, on which children skated or rode on sleds drawn by husky dogs. On the way to the libraries or Yomei's theater school, the two of them often bought breakfast at bakeries, each having a Danish or a puff, munching on the pastry while walking. Along the streets, sometimes the fresh snow was so heavy that the electricity lines dipped into long, diving curves. Near the bridge, they found a small patisserie that sold fried turnovers stuffed with apple or eggs mixed with rice, somewhat like the vegetable buns they used to eat back in China. So whenever there was no line at the store, they'd each get a large turnover for 1 ruble and 20 kopecks. The owner, pink-faced and with crisp white hair, would beam at them while wrapping their purchase in wax paper and then tell them to come again. They both looked younger than they were, so the man took them to be in their mid-teens and called them girls. When they left the bakery, their fingers would be interlaced as they strolled away chewing on the turnovers. Every once in a while, some international figures would appear at the Hotel Lux to speak to the Cominternians from various countries. One afternoon in the spring of 1940, Lily came back and said excitedly to Yomei, "Do you know Li De, the German officer who used to command the Red Army in China, is going to speak here tomorrow evening?" "You mean Otto Braun?" asked Yomei. "Yes, that's the man. He's going to talk about the Chinese Red Army to some international comrades." "He flew back to Moscow on the same plane with me, so I should go listen to him and say hello." The next evening, they went to the conference room on the ground floor to hear him talk. Otto Braun looked exhausted, a little haggard, and apparently he hadn't been doing well. In the introduction, Kyushin, the man in charge of Chinese affairs at the Comintern, mentioned that Otto was working at the Foreign Language Press now as a translator and an editor and was going to update them about the CCP's military affairs. At the lectern, Otto grew more animated as he spoke about the structure of the leadership in the Chinese Red Army, which was basically a force composed of rebellious peasants and troops who had surrendered from the Nationalist Army. Obviously, the audience here, especially those from European countries, were unfamiliar with his topic, so he was patient in explaining the details and some terminology he used. According to him, the CCP still had some 30 divisions scattered in different provinces. Each, on average, consisted of about 7,000 troops. But the army was poorly equipped, each division having only 4 or 5 light mortars and less than 50 machine guns and 200 or 300 horses. In contrast, Chiang Kai-shek's Nationalist Army had a great deal of aid from international capitalist powers and was equipped with German and American weapons, including tanks and heavy artillery pieces, armored vehicles, and bombers. But the CCP's military leadership was strong and capable. Otto admitted that he had been less adequate compared to his former Chinese comrades because he hadn't known the country folk and the geography well enough to give effective directives. During his tenure there, he based his assessments and analyses mainly on telegrams and statistics gathered by his aides. With a touch of bitterness, he praised Mao as a strategist, saying the man was brilliant and thoroughly seasoned with battle experiences, though he was sure Mao couldn't even fire a gun or pitch a grenade. Otto had attended several talks given by Mao, who he could tell was humorous, earthy, and charismatic, a natural leader, although at times Mao could be diabolical like a bandit. Knowing Otto couldn't eat red chili, Mao had once announced to a crowd, "Fried red chili is a revolutionary foodstuff. Whoever cannot eat fried red chili is not a revolutionary." Otto's account cracked up the audience. He also mentioned Bo Gu and Luo Fu, top leaders of the CCP who had both studied in the USSR for years and were fluent in Russian. He liked Luo Fu, Zhang Wentian, a lot, saying the man also spoke good English, having lived in the United States for years, too. In every way, the two foreign-educated men were international revolutionaries. Sometimes they were both uncomfortable about Mao's nationalistic vision and narrow-mindedness, but they did their best to accommodate Mao for the sake of the party's solidarity. Unlike them, Mao was natively bred, never having stepped foot outside China, yet he was full of vitality and peasant cunning and particularly good at guerrilla warfare. He was a far superior leader to the others in the CCP. In comparison, Zhou Enlai was a great administrator, unflagging, astute, and always adaptable, but he was not a capable military strategist. For some years, Zhou had been the actual commander of the Red Army, but about 6 years back, he had switched to Mao's side and supported Mao unconditionally. Indeed, Mao stood out among the top leaders who all seemed willing to follow him even when they didn't fully understand his intentions. Otto was confident that with Mao as its top commander, the Red Army would continue to flourish and might take over the whole of China in the future, despite its shabby current state. Yomei was impressed by Otto's candor and big-heartedness. The man had been defeated by his China mission and disliked by his Chinese colleagues, but he showed little bitterness. Yomei had overheard the Zhous talking about Otto as an inexperienced military advisor.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.